Now back to Clout with Richard Green.
And we are returning to our special here on Clout, giving time to surrogates to voice their opinions, their insights about these two extraordinary presidential candidates on the eve of an historic vote. I think we're going to have a woman or an African-American running this country. I pray that we do not have any of the Republicans who are running. I think we are done with that era in our history. Our first hour was on Hillary Clinton. Our second hour right now is devoted to Barack Obama. It is Barack Obama Hour, and I called the person I thought would be the most meaningful to start off this hour. His name is Reverend Joseph Lowery. You know this person, even if you don't know the name. Here's how you know him.
We know now there were no weapons of mass destruction over there. But Coretta knew, and we know that there are weapons of misdirection right down here.
And that was Reverend Joseph Lowery at the funeral of his dear friend, Coretta Scott King. He had worked with and walked with Martin Luther King and helped found the Southern Christian Leadership Council. Reverend Joseph Lowery, welcome to Clout here on Air America.
Well, thank you so much for having me.
Now, you are very passionate about this young man, Barack Obama, aren't you?
Yes, I am. And not so much him personally, but what he represents, what he stands for, and what he's done to such a large segment of American people, particularly our young people. I see him as the face of tomorrow. I've watched and shared as he electrified crowds of thousands, a mosaic, young and old, black, brown, and white, Democrat, Republican, Independent. This is the America of our dreams and our prayers, and Obama, to me, is clearly the candidate not only to unite us, but to energize and inspire us to work together to meet the very challenging goals that the change he talks about will demand.
Now, you mentioned to me some time ago that you thought that Barack Obama was, in fact, what Dr. King was fighting for, that to have that moment where a man as he is could be in a position to be the next president of the United States. Is that accurate, what you feel?
Well, I think that's accurate, but I think the deeper question is America ready to visualize Dr. King's dream in flesh and blood, the dream of the movement that not only Dr. King but black and white together shared and worked for, went to jail for, black and white people died to foster that dream. Does America visualize that dream in the flesh and blood, in the person of Barack Obama? He's made us feel good about ourselves. He's inspired us to be ready to tackle the job of untying the knots that deter us in our political process, to break the chains that imprison us in our racial and gender attitudes. He makes me feel good about myself all over again, and he made thousands yearn to bring into being the land our forefathers dreamed and planned, a land of opportunity, to crown our good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. And I love a rap, a song I just saw on the Internet that says, "Yes, we can, yes, we can," sung by people from all walks of life in concert with Obama's speaking. I think America is ready for that level of change, and already we have begun to believe, yes, we can.
Now, this may be an unfair question, but you knew Dr. King so well. What do you think he would have thought about Barack Obama?
Well, I think he'd be very pleased. I think he'd be shouting along with me and others as I worked an hour in the campaign for a weekend, to see a state 95% white say to the rest of the world, yes, we can. We can judge a person by the content of their character rather than the color of their skin. We can vote for a person based on his qualifications and his vision, his ability to energize and lead people in a new direction. That's the question, and I'll answer it positively. And even in South Carolina, he got more than 25% of the white vote. I'm so proud of our country and the direction that we seem willing to go under the leadership of Barack Obama.
Now, you were talking before about whether America is ready to realize Dr. King's dream. There's been a lot of talk about whether Barack Obama is ready. You've seen a lot of leaders in this country for many years. Do you think Barack Obama is ready to be the president of this country?
I think he's ready, willing, and able. And I also think he's called. He has a mystique that I can't define.
You said called. Called. C-A-L-L-E-D.
C-A-L-L-E-D. Called by a power higher than any of us. And I can't explain it, so don't ask me. But I feel it. I sense it. As I moved around the country January of 2007 on about 8 or 10 university campuses, I saw faculty and students, and particularly the students, energized, inspired, really traumatized in a positive way by what this man inspired in them. And that's when I began to search, because I didn't know him before he was announced. I knew of him, but I didn't know him. So I talked with friends of mine in Chicago, pastors, layperson, who knew him well. They all feel the same way. I think he can help us restore faith in ourselves, in our destiny as a nation. What would be more powerful to restore respect among the family of nations than for Barack and Michelle to be in the White House of the United States of America?
Well, I was mentioning in the last hour that I heard Michelle Obama speak yesterday at UCLA with Oprah Winfrey and Maria Shriver, and I was blown away. This woman is as good as he
gifted,
is as a speaker.
Gifted, inspired, and I believe summoned by moral forces that we may not be able to fully grasp to serve in this time. There was nothing more powerful in the Book of Esther that when Mordecai said to Esther, "You've come to the kingdom for such a time as this." I think the combination of factors, the time people are hungry and thirsty for change. And I think Barack Obama is the instrumentality, the human instrumentality that can lead us in that direction.
One more question, Reverend Lowry. We know that you've met Hillary Clinton. You were up on the stage at Coretta Scott King's funeral, speaking in front of her, as well as George and Laura Bush, and in total four presidents. And I know you've been to the White House during the Clinton years. Why are you not supporting Hillary Clinton?
Well, because you can't vote twice. You can only vote once. I have great admiration and appreciation for the leadership of Bill Clinton and Hillary as the First Lady of the White House, and I think she's done a good job as Senator. But I do think the time has come for change. I think there's a sense in which they represent the 20th century, and this man helps us look toward the 21st century and on into the years of that new century and new millennium. I think their time has come and passed to be president of the United States. I believe that we saw their reach into the past after her defeat in Iowa. I was very disappointed at her reaction, and particularly President Clinton's attack on Obama. I thought it was clear indication that was time for change. So I think they served us well, and now it's time for a new servant. And that servant, I believe, is Barack Obama.
Well, I tell you, Reverend Joseph Lowry, I think that you are America's greatest living orator. I think you are an American treasure.
Would you mind repeating that? I'm going to bring my wife in to listen.
I'm sure she knows it. You are 86 years old. How long have you been married?
Oh, my God. Will you let me tell, baby? We're between 55 and 60.
Between 55 and 60. Well, Reverend Lowry, honestly, I have met no one in my entire life that I would rather have as president of this country. And unfortunately, you are not running.
No, thank you. No, thank you.
Anyway, it's a delight, as always, to have you on, sir. Thank you for your words. I believe they've been inspiring to many people who are making this very, very difficult decision. And we will talk to you soon.
I thank you so much for letting me on. And remember, yes, we can.